Good morning, everyone. Welcome you in this second session of our economy current affairs classes. I hope yesterday's session was very much clear about whatever we have discussed. So still you have any doubt, you can WhatsApp me through my number I have given yesterday. So let's start today's class with one new topic, that is your scrapping policy is very much introduced in this this year's budget. So scrapping policy, I think you have already have an idea about this scrapping policy. It's very much related to your environment. What is that? I yesterday also I have already told you that whenever you read any scheme or any policy, just try to find out the rationality behind it or the objective. This is very much significant for your prelims as well as mains. What, why this scheme was launched? Okay, so the first or the main objective behind this scrapping policy to check the environmental pollution. To check the environmental pollution. What is that? The objective or the key components of this scrapping policy is to phase out old and unfit vehicles. I think you have seen on the road of your city that some of the buses, the old buses of the government as well as of private buses, it emits a lot of like smoke. Okay, so that is dangerous for the environmental pollution, specifically to the air pollution. That's why government has come up with one voluntary policy. It is not mandatory, it's voluntary in nature. So ichha, I mean citizens of this country voluntarily participate in this scrapping policy. That means those buses or vehicles are unfit or environmentally polluting or emitting more smoke, okay, that must be scrapped. I think few years back Delhi High Court, I guess Delhi High Court or maybe Supreme Court, if I'm not wrong, that 10 years old vehicle must be scrapped from the Delhi road because of this pollution and all. So in this scrapping policy also, to phase out the old and unfit vehicles, and it is a voluntary scheme, voluntary in nature. There is no such law that is abided by the citizen, no such law backing this scrapping policy. It is a voluntary in nature. What are the other components? Other components is this testing centers will be automated testing centers will be established among different parts of the city, or fitness centers specifically. Those centers will check the fitness of the vehicle. So if a private vehicle is more than 20 years, that must be scrapped from the road. Private vehicle, it's 20 years duration. I yesterday also I have told you that UPSC has a habit of playing with numbers, so please be careful with this. Private vehicles, or you can say personal vehicles, you have car, your Fiat car of your old of your family, then that must, if it's 20 years old, that must be scrapped. This is the first key component of this policy. The second one is, in case of commercial vehicles, the 15 years old vehicle must be scrapped, in case of commercial vehicles. So just remember it, commercial, it is lesser years or lesser number, that is your 15. in case of personal or private, it is more, that is your 20 years. Okay. So what would be the benefits? Let's see some of the benefits, as it's very much clear from this name that it suggests this scrapping of old vehicle from the road. That is the first benefit would be your it encourages it fuel efficiency. As you know, the rate of petrol and diesel is very much in news. We have already achieved the century with that. So this fuel efficiency must be there. So the first benefit would be with the scrapping policy, the new vehicles, I mean the Bharat 6-stage vehicles should be on the road, and it would be lesser polluting and fuel efficient in nature. The second one is environmental friendly. Yes, the basic objective behind this policy, environmental friendly. Second one is reducing vehicular pollution. When this, as you know, during the winter time, those who are living in Delhi or you follow the news, that Delhi is choked with this smog, that is fog and smoke and all. So air pollution is very much bad during the winters in Delhi. So during the survey by different authorities, it has been derived that vehicular pollution has a very much higher percentage in terms of this Delhi air pollution problem. And it has been, it's not case in case, I mean specific to Delhi. Most of the cities, those cities are expanding, and like cosmopolitan, that culture is emerging. So these cities are suffering from this air pollution, and it's this vehicle scrap policy would be helpful in case of those avoid this environmental problem. And the last one, as you know, India is not self-sufficient in case of oil production, and we have a larger share in case of our import basket of this petroleum products. So it will reduce this oil import bill. That is another, it is very much related to with the first point. If vehicles are fuel efficient, then it must reduce this oil import bill, or your current account deficit, the amount you are importing from other countries for your oil, or the to fulfill your demand of oil in your country, that will be reduced. So these are some of the benefits of this scrapping policy. If you have any doubt on this, please let me know through my number, and we'll discuss it further. We'll try to make it clear about it. So let's move to the next topic. This topic is very much was launched, I think, in 2014 or 15, when this NDA government in 2014 came to the power, and this policy is very much is in news, and already been asked in UPSC mains, I guess. So this policy is Urban Swachh Bharat Mission 2.0. Urban Swachh Bharat Mission, I mean they are focusing more on the urban areas due to, as you know, in your syllabus 1 of your GS, urbanization is a topic. And urbanization is a problem. I think you all have studied about it. So that's why this Urban Swachh Bharat Mission 2.0, the government of India or Union government introduced in this year's budget. So the first, what are the key components? Why we have come up with this Urban Swachh Bharat Mission? Already we have this Swachh Bharat Mission. What is the need of this specific focus on this urban Swachh Bharat mission. The first one is waste water management. As you know, urbanization is urban population is increasing, more people are migrating to the cities for the better standard of living and for the livelihood. So urbanization is a problem and waste water management is a challenge in this urbanization era. That's why one of the key component of the Swachh Bharat Mission 2.0 is your waste water treatment. Okay, so the first point is waste water treatment. Fecal sludge management is another challenge of urbanization. That also we are focusing on this urban Swachh Bharat mission. Okay. If you have seen in your cities that this municipality or this garbage collection unit of this municipality, they are coming in the morning to your doorstep, and they are asking whenever you ready your dustbin or you ready your garbage, so please divide it into two different segments, that is your wet and dry. So one of the key component of this Swachh Bharat Mission 2.0 is that is your source segregation of garbage. Once you mix it, this wet and dry, it's very much difficult for the local authority to manage this waste. Okay, so that's why they are appealing to the people, just divide this garbage, that is your wet and dry, separately at the source. I'm giving a hint on this. I think 2016 one policy was introduced by the government, that is your waste management policy, I guess. So I think 2019 they had asked one question on that. It's a environmental topic, so if possible, please go through that policy once along with this when you do this Swachh Bharat mission and all. So this source segregation of garbage, wet and dry, it must be done at the source level, so that it would be easier for the local authority to segregate this waste, and it is easier to manage also. The next aspect of this Swachh Bharat mission is, I think many of the cities are coming with this policy to eliminate the use of plastic, and specifically the reduction of use of this single use plastic. Single-use plastic, which is we are more focusing on that because of this use. We just use for it, only once, and then we throw it away. So that's why the single-use plastic is very much a key component in your urban Swachh Bharat mission. I think when you order your food from this Zomato and Swiggy app, they also ask you whether you want some utensils or not. Now they have dropped this option, I guess. They are not asking for the extra utensils. Whatever they are giving, food with that plastic utensils only they are offering. So once you consume that food, you throw it away, that particular plastic. So that is your single use plastic. So one of the key component of this is to reduce this single-use plastic. Okay. Another key component of this Swachh Bharat Mission 2.0 is your reduction in air pollution. When Delhi was choking from the last 2-3 years. One of the cause of it, this burning of this the waste of those crops by this Haryana and Punjab, the belt. So that was the major reason. Vehicular pollution was one of the reason, and one other reason was this construction activities. So during winter, if pollution level goes high, they generally stop temporarily this construction activities. So that is another component under this Urban Swachh Bharat mission, that is to reduce the air pollution, and the only way out is managing the waste from construction and demolition activities. Okay, managing the waste from construction and demolition activities. This is another key component of this. Let's moving to another significant key component is management of the waste through a method that is known as your bioremediation. I think you already have read it in your environment classes, bioremediation. Bioremediation, you can, if possible, please answer me through my number, WhatsApp. What is the meaning of this bioremediation? Is a technique which is used to manage the waste, but what is the exact process of it? Okay. Bioremediation. So, moving to the next subtopic, or you can say one topic in this budget. From the last, from March 2020, we are struggling with this pandemic. The whole world is struggling with this pandemic, actually. And now the only way forward is your maintaining this distance, use of this mask and your sanitizer, and other one is your vaccination. So, we have, or the government of India is also giving emphasis on this vaccination process, and we are also investing more in this vaccination or research and development in this vaccination process. So, with that thing keeping in mind, this budget also discussed about this pneumococcal vaccine. Pneumococcal vaccine. Pneumococcal vaccine, or it's the disease which is to deal with the disease that is your pneumonia. To deal with the disease pneumonia, this pneumococcal vaccine is developed and is purely a made in India product. Last year, during this November and December, I think October onwards, government of India came up with one initiative, that is your Atmanirbhar. That is your self-reliance. We'll see more about it. So that self-reliance or Atmanirbhar, this one such, one such innovation in this field, pneumococcal vaccine, which deals with this disease, pneumonia. Okay, so it's a made in India product. And it will avert more than, I repeat, it will avert more than 50,000 child, more than 50,000 child death annually due to this disease, pneumonia. Okay. So this is the objective behind this pneumococcal vaccine. So this is all about your health initiative that has been introduced in this year's budget. Now we are moving to the next component of our discussion, that is your physical and financial capital. Physical and financial capital. And your infrastructure. Physical and financial capital and your infrastructure. I'm giving you one hint on this, which is very much relevant for your prelims. 2019 or 20, if you have gone through the previous year paper, you will find one question related to human capital. So this 12th class NCERT, this Indian Economic Development, is very much dedicated one unit or one sub unit related to this capital, human capital, in a specific manner. So if possible, just refer to that, because that question was directly from the NCERT chapter only. So physical and financial capital or your infrastructure. Just I told you few minutes back that Atmanirbhar Bharat we launched during the October and November of 2020 last year. This Atmanirbhar is something which is your self-reliance in nature. The self-reliance is not new for our Indian economy. If you read the planning topic or your 5-year plan, you will find one of the key component or key objective of this 5-year plan is your self-reliance. And others like growth, social justice, these are some of the other objectives, employment generation, these are some of the other objectives. But one of the key objective of this 5-year plan is your self-reliance. So self-reliance is not a new for us on this Atmanirbhar initiative by the taken by the government. It was there in the planning. What we did during this Atmanirbhar, let me introduce or brief about that areas or that particular times Atmanirbhar, so that you can compare with the present time. During this planning period, we saw that this your Mahal Nobis model of this industrialization. Mahal Nobis model, we started industrialization process and we gave much emphasis to the public sector, because private was not, or private players or private parties were not that much capable to initiate this rapid industrialization process. That's why we gave much importance to the public sector, so that we can self-sufficient or self-reliant, or that will reduce the dependency on other countries. This was the objective behind this self-reliance. Now what we are doing, why we launched this? Now also we have seen, when this pandemic came, we were not prepared to deal with this situation. We are not prepared, because when this pandemic started, all the countries stopped this movement of the people, then this flight movement was stopped and everything. Some countries they came forward for this help and all, Some countries also denied this helping. That recently this US-India relation with respect to this help of this I mean in terms of vaccine and medicine and all. So we have seen that. So that's why we have launched this Atmanirbhar or self-sufficient, so that we should strong enough to face these kind of problem. So this Atmanirbhar we launched, that is your self-reliance. As a part of this Atmanirbhar Bharat, one scheme was launched, that is your PLI. What is that PLI? This is your production linked incentive scheme. I repeat, production linked incentive scheme, part of this Atmanirbhar Bharat. Production linked incentive scheme. What is the rationality or what is the objective? Objective was, see, the point is, during the planning era, when we just discussed this self-reliance, that was basically to promote your home or domestic industries. Those who have this economics as an optional, they might have heard about this that is your something. I mean, we try to protect the industries of our country, and we raise the bar, so that the foreign countries, they cannot easily access to our domestic market, so that our industry will grow. So that argument is known as infant industry argument. You have heard about it. So that also, it's not required for you. I just gave a hint so that you can understand this concept, Atmanirbhar. So during that planning period, we protected our industries to grow, okay. But this times Atmanirbhar is little bit different from the earlier one. That is, we are promoting both foreign as well as local, foreign as well as local industries. This was the objective of present era's Atmanirbhar or this production linked incentive scheme. So this was the to promote foreign as well as the local industries. Another key component of this production linked incentive scheme was, when your foreign as well as local industries will grow, definitely they will generate employment. This is the second objective of this production linked incentive scheme. So question could be like, what are the objectives or what are the benefits we get from production linked incentive schemes? The first one is your generate employment, or it can create employment opportunities in our country. This is the first one. Second one, when you will promote the foreign industries or foreign companies in our country as well as your local industries, then the objective behind is your self-reliance. That means it will reduce the import bill. It will reduce the import bill. That means whatever, till now, whatever you are importing from other countries or the product on which you are dependent, now you are producing or growing in our own countries. That's why it will reduce this import bill, or it will cut down this reliance on import from other countries. So, what are the provisions under this production linked incentive schemes? That means, find it out how much industries this production linked scheme has been extended. Okay, so you just find it out. 20 plus industries, 25 or 28. I cannot recall it perfectly. So please find it out. 25 or 28 industries, this production linked incentive schemes have been provided. And what is the key component on this? The key component is, up to next 5 years, incentive would be provided with the range of 4 to 6%. I repeat, up to next 5 years, incentive would be provided 4 to 6%. One example, let me give you. IT industries, IT industries, and the incentive is ranged from 4 to 6%, let us say. So, within that IT industries, suppose one Samsung company is the mobile phone company, and it produces a phone of rupees 15,000. I am just giving you one example, just focus on it. Suppose, let us say mobile company Samsung producing a cell phone of this 15,000, that means government will provide 6% incentive to this particular cell phone company. Okay, 6% incentive, that means the cost of this product, the 6% cost of this product would be provided by the government, only to encourage the manufacturing unit. To encourage the manufacturing unit, I am just going behind or some story behind this initiative and all. I am giving you a brief about it so that you can link in a proper manner. As you know, there are three sectors broadly. One is your primary, secondary, and your tertiary. Let us say agriculture, manufacturing, or your industry, your service sector. I repeat, try to understand this concept. If you understand it, then you can interlink many things with this manufacturing, this production linked incentive schemes, as well as the initiatives taken by the government to improve this industrialization process or to expand this manufacturing units in India. So, three sectors: primary, that is agriculture, manufacturing and industry, then service sector. Okay. Generally or ideally, in an economy, what happens? A country grows like this. First, your agricultural sector. Then we come to this manufacturing stage, and then we come to this service sector stage. This is the ideal curve of a country's growth pattern. First agriculture, then industry or your manufacturing unit, then your service. But India has a different story. during this 1990s or when we adopted this LPG policy. What was that story? India started with this agriculture and simply jumped to service sector. We have omitted this stage. We started with the agriculture, then we shifted to the service sector. We omitted this this stage of manufacturing or this industrialization process. Due to that, I mean, why such shift was there? Because of this, when you opened your economy in 1990s, when you opened your economy in 1990s, then more number of service sectors came to India, and service sector has a capacity or potential to give a speedy rate of growth. Okay, gestation period is low in case of service sector. This was the one reason. Second reason was for the manufacturing unit or the industrial unit, you need certain skilled manpower which you are lagging or the India is lagging, and we shifted to this service sector. That's why your manufacturing unit could not generate much employment. Could not generate much employment, first one. Second one, your growth rate or the contribution of this sector or manufacturing unit to the GDP remain stagnant. Clear? Two problems India's manufacturing unit is suffering. First, employment generation and stagnancy. This was the whole story of India's growth pattern. We shifted from the agriculture to services, and generally it is known, or the general pattern of the growth rate is from agriculture sector to the surplus force will be shifted to industry. That we could not realize due to this stagnancy and all. That's why this employment generation capacity was lowered of this manufacturing unit. So due to this problem, and you could not absorb every or surplus agricultural manpower in this service sector. Service sector has a another requirement, okay? Like your when this 1990 started, you will see the high demand of this MBA programs, the management. Then your BPO and KPO also started. English speaking people also was in demand to serve in the country, to serve in the companies, those who are outsourcing this service from India. So that kind of separate skill was also required. That's why you cannot absorb surplus manpower from the agriculture to service sector. This was the whole story of Indian economy or Indian pattern of growth. So now this time has come when this 2014, when this NDA government came, that's why it started more emphasis on this skill development programs. Varieties of skill development program came. Now we have included this vocational education, we are giving more emphasis. We have included the curriculum of skill development in the schools and colleges and all. So that's why the skill development was the main focus. And now we have realized that our manufacturing unit has that potential. We have learned from our neighbors, like your Bangladesh, your China. These countries, I mean, we'll see a few minutes after a few minutes that how this small scale industries has done a miracle. So we are also going or moving into that path to set up more number of manufacturing units, so that it will help in terms of employment generation. Self-reliance is also another objective, and the third one is it will help in the achieving the targeted growth rate. That's why this production linked incentive schemes was introduced by the government. So government will incentivize this manufacturing units. Okay, so this was the idea behind this launch of this production linked incentive scheme. Let's see some of the other objective or key components of this production linked incentive scheme. I think it's clear what I am trying to keep in front of you. That see, the point is, these are facts. What are the key components under this scheme? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But the point is, the only you can understand this, you can use it, or you can apply in a particular answer, or you can solve question when this background you must know. So that's why I briefed a background of this India's growth pattern or India's pattern of this development model, so that you can understand the rationality behind this launching of this particular schemes. Okay. Yes, the key another key component of this production in linked incentive scheme is it will help in bring large scale and size. You can increase the size of the manufacturing unit, or you can increase the large scale production in case of manufacturing units. If you increase the size and scale, then two things happen. One is your production cost will decrease. Goods will be cheaper, demand will be more. Simple economics. Production cost will reduce. The second one is, it demands more skilled manpower, so employment generation. So these are some of the benefits to if you increase the large scale or the size of the scale and the size of the production capacity. Another key objective, see, the point is, why China is so much a giant economy. The fundamental or the base, or you can say the foundation of Chinese economy, is your manufacturing unit. After this during this last lockdown, I remembered everyone like this Nara came, this boycott the Chinese products and all. We have banned this Chinese app and all. Still, if you go to the market, you will find a good number of Chinese products. Okay, even the phone we are using, they are Chinese companies, although they are manufacturing in India. That's a different story. But still, Chinese has that dominancy in this electronic market. Toys, now we have banned it, but yes, if you see the 3-4 years back, you will see the flooded this toys market, the Chinese toys, okay, at a very cheaper rate. So manufacturing unit was the foundation or the background or the backbone of the Chinese economy, and we are simply just trying to do that, so that to increase the size and scale of the of our manufacturing unit. So with this production linked incentive scheme, we are trying to create and nurture global champions. Nurture global champions. What are these champions? Those manufacturing unit that will outperform. Okay, those performance will be much better. We will consider them as a global champions, and we'll promote them, we will facilitate them for the more production. This was the whole story behind this production linked incentive scheme. Okay, if you have any doubt, please you can message me in my number, you can through WhatsApp. So the basic or the basic principle of this whole discussion is you must understand this idea behind this launching of different schemes. Facts you can easily remember, you have time, if you read it once or twice you can easily remember. The point is, see, the if you have seen this old trees, I mean old banyan trees or something, old trees that is of 100 years, 150 years, you will see their roots are much, I mean the roots is spread in a much larger area. Okay, that means they are so much strong, they have, I mean that base is so much strong, that roots, I mean you can sit on that roots are above this soil, you can sit all there also. So idea is you can you just try to link your knowledge, I mean interlink your knowledge to different different category or different sections, so that you can understand in a better manner, you can memorize it in a better manner if you link it with other stream of knowledge. So that is the main idea, to revise the background as well as the discussion of this rationality of these schemes. So moving forward, the next topic, that is your textile industry. Textile. Few years back, I think 2015 or 16, if I am not wrong, one chapter was dedicated to this textile industries in economic survey. What was the idea, why this so much emphasis was given to the textile industry? The first thing, the first point on this textile industries, it's not yes, there are some large scale, but mostly these are concentrated in a small scale units. And that economic survey, which was dedicated a chapter to this textile industries, it was discussed that the textile industries of Bangladesh and all, how it helps in the women empowerment, because women are more in number in participating in this textile industries. As you know that when women of a family will income, then the better standard of living for the children, better food, nutrition and etcetera, you all are aware about it. So that economic survey dedicated this chapter of this textile, how this small scale industries are growing in the Bangladesh and all, what we should learn from this model of development. So with that notion or with that background, we are also emphasizing to this rapid growth of this textile industries because of this small scale units. Why we are giving so much emphasis to the small scale units? Because they are labor intensive. In 2015, if you go through the previous year paper, I am time and again I am highlighting the previous year paper, because yesterday also I told you that generally UPSC do not repeat the question, they repeat the topic. So if possible, try to cover at least 10 to 15 years of previous year paper thoroughly and with an analysis of all the options given by the UPSC. Okay, it's not that you just go through the question and just find out the answer from a key book, it's not like that. Just analyze what was the, I mean, the mind of the examiner while he or she framed this question, and what are the key options they have given, so that you can learn how to eliminate the wrong options and find out the right one. So that mindset you need to understand while you go through previous year papers time and again. That's why I am also referring to these previous year papers. So in 2015 you will find one question on this labor intensive and capital intensive. Okay. So small scale industries are more of labor intensive. Okay. Labor intensive means more labor are used with respect to capital. Suppose 70 labors, 30 capital. This was the proportion. I mean, it's just a sample example. 70 labor and 30 is the capital. So this industry is will be known as your labor intensive. More use of labor, simple logic. So the small scale industries are labor intensive in nature. That means it will generate more employment. It will generate more employment. First. Second, it has a share in the GDP growth. Okay. So the larger is the sector, the share of in growth rate will be much higher, so that it will contribute in the growth rate of your economy. That's where we're giving emphasis on this of your small scale industries, and specifically to this textile one. Let's see what are the initiatives taken by the government in this budget with respect to your textile industries. Okay. So a scheme was launched in this year's budget, that is your Mitra. What is the full form of this Mitra? Full form is Mega Investment Textile Parks. Mega Investment Textile Parks Mitra. Under this scheme, one key component is textile parks should be built. Textile parks would be built. And it has a target to build 7 textile parks in next 3 years. 7 textile parks in next 3 years. This was the idea, or this was the initiative taken by the government under this textile, and I have already told you why we are giving emphasis. One is your generate employment, share in the growth rate. Third one, if you build this textile parks, that means it will help in your attracting larger investment. It will help in attracting large investment. And you want to establish a global hub of textile industries in our country. Global hub of textile industry. So this was the whole story or whole idea about the initiative taken under this textile industries. I think it's clear. Yesterday also I had given to upload this material PDF one. If it's still not been uploaded, please let me know. I will ask to upload it. Today also I will give it, so that by evening you will get the PDF. So the broad outline of the discussion you will get, and if you want to write, then it's up to you. It's you can write it. Okay. So moving ahead, the infrastructure. It's a topic exclusively mentioned in your mains GS paper 3 main syllabus, but sometimes UPSC also ask in prelims, and specifically we'll see what are the initiatives taken by the government or introduced policy or schemes in this budget. So it's very much relevant for us. So the first one is okay, let me brief the background also, that why we are giving infrastructure, because it has that potential to make a country from developing to a developed one, and everything is very much related to your infrastructure, because in a particular city, let's say a state capital, if you do not provide the basic infrastructure facility in that particular city, then no one will come to invest in that particular area. You need good railway services, road services, your airport services, or your air services, air connectivity and all. So infrastructure is very much important for the development of a particular region. So with that keeping in mind, so one national infrastructure pipeline. National infrastructure pipeline was launched, and it's from 19 to 25. So national infrastructure pipeline was launched. It was from 2019 to 25, the tenure of this national infrastructure pipeline. See, the point is, if you divide in a broad category of this infrastructure, then it has two components. One is your economic, another one is your social. But when we see, or we say this infrastructure word, this component comes to our mind, this economic one. Just I also said that railways, air services, your roads, the economic one. But the social infrastructure is your education and health. So this national infrastructure pipeline, focusing on both your economic as well as the social one. I mean, along with this development of your roads, railways, ports and air connectivity and all, we are also emphasizing on this education as well as your health. How we can do that? We can do through institutional structure, or creating institutional structure. How is that institutional structure. We'll discuss after a few minutes. Just wait for that. So first one is your creating institutional structure. Second is your monetizing assets. We are discussing that how we can develop this economic as well as the social infrastructure. The first one was creating institutional structures. Second one is your monetizing assets. What is this monetizing assets? Creation of new source of revenue. Creation of new source of revenue. What is that new source of revenue? By unlocking or by using the unutilized public assets. As you know, disinvestment, by selling the assets of the public units or public sectors to the private, through that also we generate a lot of revenue. So this is one source. Second, your let's say your selling of your spectrum, okay, like your 2G, 3G, 4G and 5G and 5G and on. So selling of spectrum also you generate revenue. So monetizing assets means you will unlock the unutilized public assets and to generate new source of revenue. The third, one is your to increase the share of capital expenditure. Increase the share of capital expenditure. Increase the share of capital expenditure in central and state budget. What is this share of capital expenditure in state and central budget? That means the expenditure. What is that capital expenditure? I think you all are aware about it. What is that capital expenditure? The expenditure which helps in building infrastructure. That will help in building your infrastructure. That is your capital expenditure. So the share of capital expenditure of central and state budget will increase, so that it will help in expanding the infrastructure facility, both in economic as well as the social one. Okay. So just we'll continue this session. I just want your 2 minutes break. I am just coming back. 2 minutes break only.
Welcome back. So we are discussing this monetizing asset. And the last point we discussed, that share of capital expenditure, that is your increase of share of capital expenditure in central as well as your state budget, so that we can spend more in this social as well as economic infrastructure. Okay. So next point, to give a push to this national infrastructure pipeline, or the objective to achieve the economy, the expansion of social and economic infrastructure, one task force was formed. One task force. Sometimes UPSC asks one liner question, like if you have seen that in environment also, this question was like, which committee was formed to address such issue. So this kind of one liner question generally UPSC ask. So please mind it, that one task force was formed to look after or to achieve the target of this social as well as economic infrastructure, and that one task force headed by your Atanu Chakravarti. Atanu Chakravarti, the task force was formed on national infrastructure pipeline. It was formed in to give a push to national infrastructure pipeline, and it was headed by Atanu Chakravarti. So it also submitted its report in 2020 May. In the month of May, it submitted its report. So let's see what it recommended. Okay. What it recommended. The first one, setting of development of financial institutions. It recommended that setting of development of financial institutions for this infrastructural development. This was the first recommendation. Second one is your monetization of infrastructure. Monetization of infrastructure. Monetization of infrastructure. What is that monetization of infrastructure? That means, as you might have read in your economy subject, that is your PPP model and other model also, that let's say one toll gate will be built by one party, private party, and it will continue to collect tolls for next 10 to 15 years. Then after certain period of time, it will hand over this toll to the government. So that kind of, and at the toll you are bound to pay certain amount of money when you cross interdistrict or interstate and all. So this monetization of, if you are using certain infrastructures, then you are paying for it. So this monetization of infrastructure is one of the recommendation of Atanu Chakravarti task force. And the third one is your strengthening your municipality bond, or simply it's known as your muni bond. Strengthening municipality bond or your muni bond. What is this municipality bond? As you know, as per the 73rd and 74th amendment of the Indian Constitution, that we have given certain powers and responsibilities to the local bodies, and they have certain power to, or they have certain authority to collect the revenue and all. So, but it's not that sufficient to maintain that source of revenue. That's why policymakers and the think tanks, they are more emphasizing on this muni bond. That means they will issue like simple bond in the market, and public will invest in that, so that the source of revenue will come to the local bodies, and they can invest in the infrastructural developmental projects. Okay, that is the idea about this municipality bond or muni bond. So this Atanu Chakraborty gave emphasis to strengthen this muni bond market. Okay, apart from these recommendation, this committee or this task force also recommended to setting up three committees. Three committees. The first one is your committee to monitor the national infrastructure pipeline progress. Monitoring committee. So whatever work is done under this national infrastructure pipeline, it must be monitored by a particular committee. That is the recommendation of this task force headed by Atanu Chakraborty. Second, one steering committee at ministry level. One steering committee at each infrastructure ministry level, let us say road and transport, let us say air connectivity, let us say ministry of this port and all. One steering committee will be there to follow the implementation process. Implementation process. This is the second committee recommended by Atanu Chakraborty. Third steering committee. Third steering committee in Department of Economic Affairs to raise the revenue. To raise the revenue or to raise the financial sources for the investment. To raise the financial sources for the investment. These three committees have been recommended by this task force Atanu Chakraborty. One is your monitoring committee, that is that must be one committee must be there to monitor the progress of the work. Second one, steering committee at the ministry level to follow up the implementation process, how much this work is progressing and all, to how is it implementing at the ground level. And the third one is your financial sources at Department of Economic Affairs. Okay, so moving ahead, when we are discussing this, we started discussing this infrastructure your pipeline this topic, we saw how we can develop the infrastructure. One point or one key component was that to create institutional structures. Institutional structures. And that time I told you, just hold on, we'll discuss it after few minutes. So this is the creation of institutional structures, and this committee headed by, or the task force headed by this Atanu Chakraborty also recommended this formation of creation of institutional structure. So let's see what is this. So this institutional structure this institutional structure specifically will be named as development financial institutions. Specifically, it will be named as development financial institutions. If one question will come that consider the following statements about this development financial institutions under national infrastructure pipeline projects, what are the objectives of this development of financial institutions or rationality, or what are the benefits they can ask? So, development of financial institutions, the first one, what is the need of it? Need is, as you know, infrastructures are long term projects. It is not of 1 year, 2 year, 10 years, 20 years or 30 years of projects are there. So, this infrastructure needs a long term financing. And those parties will invest or will involve in this infrastructural projects, they need some facilitation or they need the easy way out. Okay? This, the first one is long term projects, and the second one is they need some facilitating. Facilitating or enabling financial sources. I mean, they can avail easily, they can avail finance in an easy manner. This was the rationality behind it. That is why, with that objective, this development financial institution, the initial amount or initial capital would be your 20,000 crore. The initial capital of this particular DFI or development financial institution would be your 20,000 crore. Okay. Second one, debt financing opportunity. Debt financing opportunity through InvITs, InvITs as and your REITs, that is your REITs. Debt financing opportunity through your InvITs and REITs. InvITs is your infrastructure investment trust and REITs your real estate investment trust. Both are trust, they are registered with this SEBI to finance the infrastructural projects. I repeat, both are trust and they are registered with the SEBI and they are used to finance the infrastructural projects. So, once if one InvITs is registered with SEBI, so they can easily raise funds via public as well as private parties. Once they, so before raising any fund, they have to register with the SEBI, and once they get registered from the SEBI, they can raise funds via public as well as your private parties. And this REITs is simply from like your real estate trust, and they raise funds through your real estates. So, this is the whole story of your creating institutional structures. Okay. So, moving to the next aspect, that is your monetization of assets. Monetization of assets. What are the initiative will be taken to monetization of assets? Let's see one by one. Monetization of assets. A national monetization pipeline. A national monetization pipeline would be set up, which has the potential of this brownfield investment. Anyone can answer what is this brownfield and greenfield investment? So, it has the potential of this brownfield investment, national monetization pipeline. Simply, they can ask you a question on this national monetization pipeline. You just remembered it is under this monetization of assets and under this national infrastructure pipeline projects. Okay? National monetization pipeline. So, it has potential of brownfield investment. Brownfield investment is something which is, I mean, a structure is there. You want to suppose a house is there, you want to renovate that. You are not demolishing it, you are not creating a new one, you simply renovating a particular house. That kind of investment or that kind of investment in your infrastructural projects will be known as your brownfield investment. Existing structure, just renovating it. Greenfield, simply you are developing a new one. That is the difference between brownfield and your greenfield investment. Along with this, a national monetization pipeline, an asset monetization dashboard will be created. An asset monetization dashboard. It will be created to monitor the progress. Monitor the progress of what? Monitor the progress of your all the investments. So, this is the whole story behind this monetization of assets. Okay. So, now question arises, what should be the direction of monetization or how one should proceed with this monetization process? So, your National Highway Authority of India and your Power Grid Corporation of India Limited, National Highway Authority of India NHAI and your PGCIL, Power Grid Corporation of India Limited, each have sponsored one InvIT, that is your investment trust registered with your SEBI, that is known as your regulator of financial market in India. So, they are registered, InvITs will be registered with the SEBI, launched by this NHAI and Power Grid Corporation of India Limited to attract international and domestic investors. They have done this initiative. The second one is your railways has also, they have also monetize this dedicated freight corridor. Dedicated freight corridor, they have also monetized it for this operation and maintenance. So, these are some of the examples how this monetization of asset has been done by different government authorities. Okay. So, this is the whole story about this infrastructural development or national infrastructure pipeline in specific. So, if any doubt, please let me know through my number, and we are moving forward. See, the point is each and every point or each and every sub points of this topic are very much relevant, because they can simply ask that this national monetization pipeline is related to what. I mean, simply one liner they can put before you, so that you should know the facts, you should understand the concept, so that you can easily answer whatever may be the form of the question. So, moving ahead, we are discussing this infrastructure, and the next segment is your roads and highway infrastructure. So, the point is facts are there. I mean, even you and I cannot help each other. You have to remember the facts, and you never know, I mean, the kind of the turning point the UPSC has taken. They are mixing both facts as well as the concepts, although the proportion of concepts are more, but you can never deny the fact that they will not ask you question on facts. So, and this facts has nothing to understand, you have to remember it anyway to answer this question, because the nature of prelims is like that only. So, let us see one by one what are the provisions or the initiatives that government has proposed in this budget with respect to development of roads and railway infrastructure. The first one is your increase the number of kilometers of national highway. They have targeted to increase the number of kilometers of national highway. But our job is what is the scheme or that project under which this increase the number of kilometers of highway will be there. So, that scheme is your Bharatmala Pariyojana project. Bharatmala Pariyojana project, under this the increase of kilometers of the national highway. What is the objective of to increase this kilometers of national highway? One is your passenger services, second one is your freight movement. Passenger and freight movement, to smooth and to ease the movement across this country. So, the critical infrastructure is your road and transportation. It is a critical infrastructure. So, we are focusing to develop this multimodal logistic parks. Multimodal logistics parks. We are focusing on this multimodal logistic parks and to eliminate the choke points. What is the objective of this multimodal logistic parks? That means we are exploring the alternatives of this freight movements and all, and we are reducing the burden on the conventional way of transportation and all. This is your elimination of choke point. Okay, this we'll continue with that. But before this, let me tell you some background story of it so that you can easily remember these facts or easily understand these facts. What is that background story? Our country is very much dependent for this goods movement on the road. Goods movement on the road because of the underdeveloped railway networks. Clear? But roads has their own, roads have their own limitations. The first one, we do not have certain flyovers in our country. Now we are building it, but I am just giving you an idea the what was the background so that we are working on these projects and all. We did not have certain flyovers, so whenever you want to move those trucks loaded with the goods and products to different states, they have to move into the cities of different states for this interstate movements and all. Since we do not have this bypass or separate flyover for these trucks and all, we have to enter into the cities. But if you are aware about the fact that these heavy load vehicles are not allowed in the daytimes into these cities, so that they halt in the daytime and the only movement is possible in the during the night time. That means it consumes it delays the movement. Second one, if certain trucks or these vehicles are carrying this perishable items, then the products, there is a high chance the products will be wasted and all. So these are some of the and roads are not that much of wide and all. They have to follow a certain limit in terms of speed and all. So these are some of the limitations we have with respect to your road transportation and all. That's why we are exploring the other alternatives of this infrastructure facility with respect to this freight and passenger movements in our country. So with that idea, this multimodal logistic parks we are developing, so that we are eliminating the choke points. That means the path or the way or the corridors which are overburdened in past, we are gradually releasing the pressure on them so that a easy movement of vehicles would be possible. This is the whole idea behind this multimodal logistic parks and elimination of choke points. Next point is, we are focusing on this northeast area, and its connecting or connectivity to the mainland. Okay, so we are focusing on this under this road and infrastructure, railway infrastructure. We are focusing on this northeast area and connectivity with the mainland. And the next point is your inland waterways. We are exploring more connectivity through this inland waterways. I am giving you one hint on this particular topic for your prelims. There are national waterways. Just find it out. Their source and source of connectivity of this waterways and all. So find it out and do a map study on that. So why we are focusing on this inland waterways, and from 2014 and 15 onwards, we are focusing more on this inland waterways. We discuss the limitations of road transportation in our country. One such drawback of this road transportation, that means vehicular pollution. That is your air pollution, since diesel and petrol, through this fuel, these trucks or vehicles are moving. So that's why this air pollution is there. And the next point is your high cost of transportation, since this petrol and diesel price have gone up. Okay. So that is another reason why we are more focusing on this internal waterways. That means it will reduce the air pollution. Second, it will ease out or smooth this or reduce the traffic congestion. Third, it will not much dependent on this fuel and all. So that's why inland waterways we are more targeting. Clear? This is the whole idea behind this improve the alternative connectivity in the country. Okay. So moving to the next initiative, specifically in terms of railway, that we have prepared, or Union Government or Indian Railway have prepared a plan, that is your National Rail Plan for India 2030. National Rail Plan for India 2030. National Rail Plan for India 2030, and one of such initiative under this National Rail Plan is to create a future ready railway system. Future ready railway system by 2030. Let me give you some idea behind this railway problem also, what we are suffering in terms of this railway network and all. If you go through the, I think 2014 or 15 economic survey also dedicated a chapter on this railway infrastructure. Maybe not a chapter, but one segment in that. So in a comprehensive manner, it discussed about the railway problem and all. This Indian railway was suffering from this cross subsidization problem. After that, we are increased, or we are trying to reduce this problem. Cross subsidization means that we are giving subsidies in passenger railway services, but we are collecting a higher amount of fee in terms of this freight or this goods movement, collecting more amount of fees from the goods network, and we are subsidizing this to passenger railway services. This was your cross subsidization. Now we are rationalizing this problem. Why? Since there is a higher amount of fee for this freight movement in railway network, so industries started moving to this road services. And we just discussed, road services has its own limitations. That's why we are focusing on this problem and we are trying to solve it out. Okay. Now, railway has increased the the fares of passenger this tickets price, and we are trying to rationalize this problem, and that's why one committee was formed, Vivek Debroy. Committee, and this Vivek Debroy committee also recommended how to reform this railways and all, and whether it requires a private participation in the railways or not. So these are some of the key areas you need to go through for your prelims as well as mains. Okay. So this was the problem of railways in our country. So that's why we are targeting a future ready railway network by 2030. So what was the idea behind it? The idea is to a long term perspective plan. Long term perspective plan. As you know, the meaning of this perspective plan is your long term in nature. I think in a topic of types of planning you must have read it. So that is the main idea behind it. And one such objective of this national rail plan is to increase the modal share of railways, to increase the modal share of railways to 27 to 45%. Now it's 27%, and we are targeting to increase the modal share of railways to 45% by 2030. Okay, so that means you are trying to dependent more on your railways with respect to your freight movement. You are trying to reduce the burden on the road. You are trying to increase the capacity of railway in terms of your freight movements or your goods railway network. So this modal share of railways to increase from 27 to 45% by 2030 in terms of freight. So if you do this, then your vehicular pollution, that is your road, that will also increase, that will also reduced. This vehicular pollution through this road transportation, that will be also reduced, and this modal services or the railway improvement of this railway projects will reduce the carbon emission also, because you are more moving towards the electrification. So we are more moving towards the electrification and lesser, we are reducing the share of your carbon emission. Okay. So these are some of the broad components of National Rail Plan for India 2030. This point is important because I have already told you that sometimes UPSC asks numbers. So from 27 to, we are targeting 45 by 2030. Moving to the next segment, we discussed this National Rail Plan of 2030. 2030 is a perspective plan, which is a long term one. But in a medium term plan, so this National Rail Plan also highlights one medium term plan, that is your Vision 2024. What is this Vision 2024? That means, even if your 5-year plan, you target a long term one. Whenever you prepare a schedule for your study and all, you prepare a plan of 30 days, but in between also you prepare a plan of your next 7 days, then your next 15. I mean, every week you set a target and you try to achieve that apart from your 30 days long term plan. Similarly, railway also came off along with this long term perspective plan. It came with this medium term one, that is your Vision 2024. This is a medium term plan. So, what are the targets under this Vision 2024? What are the targets under this Vision 2024 under this National Rail Plan 2030? First one is your 100% electrification. It's one extreme statement kind of thing. If you put this thing in a format of question, that under National Rail Plan and under the Vision 2024, government has decided to achieve the 100% electrification by 2024. It seems to be extreme one, but yes, it is true. It is there under this Vision 2024. If such a statement you will find in the question paper, just give a pause and try to recall it. So, 100% electrification we are targeting under this Vision 2024. Second one is your multi-tracking. What is that multi-tracking? To reduce the congestion. We are trying to increase the number of tracks so that the burden on the existing track will be reduced. To reduce the congestion, we are increasing the number of tracks, multi-tracking. Third target, if you travel through rail, delay of train or late running of a train is a habit, I say, of Indian Railway, because it's very rare that one particular train has reached in a particular time, in a given schedule or time frame. Always delay is a normal thing for Indian Railway, and one such a factor of this delay is your lesser speed. One is your capacity problem, you have not increased the speed limit of your engines. Second is your obstruction, you have less tracks, and under the existing tracks you have lot of trains are running and all. You do not have that when this express are there, when they are running late, they simply stop this express. If some express train is running late, they stop this express train and allow the local passenger train to move first, then they allow this express train. So, these kind of problem are there in our railway system. So, we are targeting to increase the speed of railway up to 160 kilometer per hour, specifically Delhi Howrah and Delhi Mumbai routes. We have started it, and soon we will gradually we will apply this speed to all over the country, but initially we have started this Delhi Howrah and Delhi Mumbai routes. The speed limit will be increased to 160 kilometer per hour. second point under this Vision 2024 is upgradation of speed limit to 130 km per hour in this golden quadrilateral and golden diagonal routes. Golden quadrilateral and golden diagonal routes. Here also, we are targeting to increase the speed of train by 130 kilometers per hour. Another initiative or another target under this Vision 2024 is elimination of all level crossing on all golden quadrilateral and diagonal quadrilateral. Okay. So, we are targeting elimination of all level crossing. So, this is another problem of our road transportation, because you have to stop a level crossing. First, they allow the train to move, then you the road services will be allowed, or the people, those who are the vehicles, are allowed to move. So, this will be eliminated. So, these are some of the targets under this National Railway Plan 2030, specifically under Vision 2024. Okay. So, today we discussed this infrastructure and your manufacturing sector, infrastructure and all. Next, we will have a power, this power infrastructure, bit a lengthy topic. We will discuss the details of it, whatever initiatives introduced by the government or generally the backgrounders we will discuss, because from last 2-3 years they are asking or they are focusing more on this infrastructure topics and all. So, initiative, schemes, policy, we will discuss it. So, tomorrow we will start a fresh, not tomorrow exactly, I think from Monday onwards we will continue the lecture series, and I think tomorrow and day after tomorrow you will have this off. So, from Monday onwards we will start this, and we will in next week itself we will complete this budget, and then we will start this economic survey. Okay. So, I think if you have any doubt, please let me know. I have given my number, I will write it once again. Any doubt, anything you have query, you can WhatsApp me through this. I would like to reply you back. So, thank you very much. Notes will be uploaded, so don't worry about that. Try to understand the background, the concepts, and try to remember the facts also, because prelims is all about that only. So, thank you very much. We will meet on Monday by this a new topic, that is your power infrastructure. So, thank you all. So, a happy weekend. Thank you.